I was fast asleep, and I hear a ringing sound that woke me up. Your heart stops for just a second so you could grasp what really is going on there. You're just thinking, oh my God, you know, I mean, this could be really crazy.
Somebody just started yelling, get up, get up, and they ran up to the stairs towards the wheelhouse, so I realized that it was an emergency. Then I seen these guys come run through the galley, like, as fast as they could. You know, a bunch of us were like, what's going on? They didn't even stop to say nothing. And they had water about up to their knees, just soaked. After I saw that, it made me just kind of freeze. I knew something was wrong. That something must be pretty bad.
Everybody kept saying that we had lost the rudder and that everything was coming in through the rudder room.
Possibly a hole had opened up or something, part of the boat had dropped off, that we were taking on a lot of water.
They had already been down in the engine room and they were trying to pump it out, but the water was coming in faster than anything else.
Everything really slowed down for me. It was kind of strange. This was probably the worst case possible and something that you don't really think is going to happen to you. When you have water coming in around electronics, it's going to be a concern. And there is so much fuel, you know. Suddenly the boat shook. This was much worse than I thought.
You know, a bunch of us were like, what's going on?
My first thought was to do what I could do to help. So I just told everybody to get up to the wheelhouse now.
We got the call at 0300. And they're saying, you know, they're going to sink any minute. The location was 197 nautical miles from where we were at St. Paul. Yeah, that was easily going to be about an hour and a half or so that we would have to fly to get there. Any extra second that somebody would have to spend in the water, even with a survival suit on, can mean the difference between life and death.
The boat just went like this fast.
I had a hold of the door going in and out of the wheelhouse. If I would have let go, I would have just fell in. Straight down, bounced off the rail and into the water. I was 100% sure that the boat was sinking.
Dan Cook and I have been around for a long time. The look on Dan's face, it told me, yeah, that this is real.
It was time to go over.
That's when the captain said abandon ship. I backfloated away from the boat about maybe 6 or 8 backstrokes. Then the boat went straight up in the air, bow first.
I saw the boat one last time from in the water. It was straight up and down, you know, the bow just straight up in the air.
And then went straight down, just like within a couple seconds. Went down that fast. The fish captain just sat there and went down with the ship. Nothing, complete nothing. I mean, it was just gone.
So cold that it didn't even hurt anymore. I was just swimming, kind of just as slowly as possible, kicking my feet. Sometimes you're even wondering, you know, I think I'm kicking them, but are they even moving? As time went on, my legs got heavier and heavier. My suit was full, about knee deep of water. I just couldn't kick my feet anymore, and I finally just laid back. I kind of just made my peace with God. I apologized for everything I did. I asked God to let my family know that I was okay going out like this. And I told God I was going to unzip my suit. That's all the fight I have left.
As we get within 1 mile, we finally see just a faint light out on the water. We see another light. Then we see a third light, fourth light. Then we just started seeing so many lights that we weren't able to count them anymore.
All of a sudden, off to my right side, just as far away as you could see, I saw a light. And it didn't look like a star. It didn't look like a suit light blinking. And then it just clicks in your mind, that's a helicopter. That's the Coast Guard. It flew right to me. It shined the light right at me. I was in the center of the beam. Oh my God, they found me. Then I saw the swimmer coming down the line, and I knew everything's gonna be okay. I stuck out my hand, and he grabbed me right here, and he just pulled me to his chest. It was the biggest sense of relief I've ever had. He put that harness around me, and then we went up. I looked at the swimmer, and I said, thank you, and they were dropping him right back down just in seconds.
I swam to the next guy. He seemed like he had his wits together.
When he brought me up, the wind from the blades on the chopper were so cold. All of a sudden, somebody reaches out and grabs you and then pulls you inside. That was the best feeling of the whole thing.
Suddenly, the side of the raft kind of illuminated. It was a warrior. And the warrior is the ugliest boat in the fleet by far, but at that time, it was the most beautiful boat. And as soon as we got tied on, all hell broke loose.
1 second, they're down at the bottom, and then next thing you know, they're 10 feet in the air. You can actually look right in their faces and see nothing but fear.
The crew members from the warrior were trying to push the Jacob's ladder out to us. Then it comes right down, and away I went. I grabbed a hold of it, and I get up enough where I get my feet in the bottom rung of the ladder. I just wasn't able to hang on, and I fell back into the water. I'm gonna get killed here. And as the boat went back down again, it created a swell or something, and I landed back onto the ladder. I crisscrossed my arms through like this around the ladder, but I said, pull me the blank up, and they'd pull me up a couple of feet at a time. And I just kept slamming outside of the boat. Took everything I could to hang on. They finally pulled me up over the side. I couldn't even stand up.
Going towards Dutch Harbor, the Monroe captain read off the names of the guys that didn't make it. David Silvera. Dan didn't make it, our chief engineer. Kono hadn't made it. Byron Carrillo didn't make it. Pete Jacobson, our captain.
I think about the Alaska Ranger every day.
Sometimes I think about the incident, but sometimes I think about all the good times and stuff I had up there too, and the people that I met.
I waited almost a year, and then I went back. When you fall off a horse, you got to get back on.
A lot of things can go wrong out there. You know, it's a part of the job. It's part of being a Bering Sea fisherman. There's a part of my soul that will always belong to the sea.
Although we did lose 5 people, the bright side is that 42 of us made it. I owe my life to the Coast Guard.
This is the largest rescue in the history of the Coast Guard.
The most remarkable thing about that night was the fact that that many people, 47 people, can go into the Bering Sea and 42 come out alive. That's a miracle. If you go in that water, in that situation, you have no right to expect to be able to come out alive.